When I was 14, I had an idea. At the time, all it was an idea, but I was determined to make it into reality. This was my idea, this wireless animatronic hand. It's involved with a control glove that's wireless that sends signals over to it to control it telerobotically. Now, at the time I was 14, I didn't really know anything about electronics, programming, circuitry, really anything like that. So it was a big learning curve for me. I turned to the internet and I found a lot of sites that really promoted learning and that really made learning easy and fun. These sites include SparkFun, Hackaday, Instructables, and the list keeps going. Now, with this glove-controlled hand, there's a lot of applications. The main application I thought of was military, for bomb defusal, for any kind of soldier out in the field. Essentially, they can put on this glove, and instead of having them learn a new claw system, it would be as if they were out there actually working in the field, and it would give a safety and really... So you can see that I can accurately control each individual finger. And you can see that there's no wires attached or anything, so it's all wireless. From there, I kept going. I liked this so much. I liked building things. I started tearing down my closet in my room, trying to make more space within my room to add more equipment. It really took off from there. I ended up making this full robotic arm up to the shoulder. And at the time, I was 16, and I didn't have a whole lot of money. I really had only the money from working over the summer. So that was a challenge, but I think that's what really helped me in the end. One of the problems I had was trying to find a compromise between strength and the cost for everything, for the motors, and there's just so many different technologies out there in the world. I ended up going with a geared DC motor to power the shoulder, and it was a challenge even finding a motor to even lift itself up. I actually had to put a feedback system on the end of the motor that will allow me to accurately control the angle of each motor, which also makes coding simpler in the end, and really, really makes it all come together. I entered this arm into the science fair, and when I was there, this seven-year-old girl came up to me. This was kind of the changing point of all this. This girl had a prosthetic arm. It was from the elbow to the fingertip. It had one sensor, and it had one motion, open, close. I started talking to her parents more and more, and that alone was $80,000. And that's a lot of money. The thing was that she was seven, that she would need probably about two or three of these in the future because she's still growing. That's hundreds of thousands of dollars, and this was really the aha moment for me. This is what really changed everything and really inspired me to help a lot of people with my designs and everything. There are other prosthetics out in the market that are similar to this and that already do have solid control systems. The main difference is definitely cost, but also how you control it. Currently, a lot of we're starting to go into neurological implants, and that's an open spinal surgery. That's extremely dangerous. I think we kind of jumped into it too soon, and it's an open spinal surgery, so it involves putting sensors within your spinal cords that tap into your neurons. There's actually a chance that the sensors could scar over, rendering it useless in the end. My approach is to keep everything external. This is an EEG headset, and these are muscle sensors. With a combination of those two, I can get a really accurate control system. This also keeps the cost down, and you can actually easily conceal this within a baseball cap, making it more publicly acceptable. From there, the cost was the big factor with prosthetics, as you know, and I wanted to keep everything cheap. I didn't have a whole lot of money, so I really had to think outside the box for a lot of things. The original arm I made, the version you see, is that was about $900, and that was cheap enough for me. But in the end, I wanted to become cheaper, but I also wanted to increase functionality. And the weight of it, I wanted to keep that low, and I wanted to make it more human-like. This is really where it's at now. I designed every single part of this within a CAD program in the computer, and the reason why it's so low in cost now is it's all 3D printed, and it's a really cool evolving technology now. It's getting cheaper, and it's getting more available to the public. You can actually go online, buy a printer, and be printing within a few days now. How it works is it's essentially a hot glue gun for ABS plastic. ABS plastic is the same plastic that Legos are made out of. And what happens is it heats that up to the melting point, and it extrudes it. And based on what model you made within the CAD program, it prints it out layer by layer until you get a physical form. That also allows me to have really human-like designs, keep everything light, keep everything durable, and the product turns out really great and affordable. Now, there are a lot of different innovations that I used with this. Even with the 3D printing technology, I actually used acetone vapor. I actually heated acetone up and used the vapor to finish the 3D printed models to give it a really nice glossy look and to have it look more professional. And actually, that increases production time. So it's a faster turnaround for prosthetics. And that really makes the final product that much better. Now, my main inspiration behind all this was I really want to continue this into prosthetics, and I really want to help a lot of people. I'm getting to that point where this is starting to get into the prosthetic industry, and it's really evolving into that point. And actually, probably within a few weeks, I might have this hooked up to an MS patient, kind of as a last wish type thing, and that's really the main thing that keeps me going with all this. So I love the work, and I'm all self-taught with everything, and I hope to keep going with this. There are also a lot of other applications and platforms for this, including NASA. NASA actually contacted me, and I'm actually going to work with them to incorporate a lot of this newer technology with neural control, different cost factors, different materials, all sorts of different things to create this telerobotic platform that's actually will be going up into space and assisting astronauts. So there's all sorts of different things that this can be used for. But at the end of the day, I really want to help people and really give them a new life. Together, we can push the movement of technology and really we can give the world a helping hand. Thank you.